kingdom come. Surely nations were not made for war. Oh, the broken meant to be ignored. Surely this just can't be what you saw. Let your kingdom come.
With a
morning. Welcome to church, everybody. Happy Father's Day to everyone that's a father, as well as today we get to recognize God as our father, so that's pretty cool. So excited, so happy you guys are here with us this morning. Excited just to come to this place to worship and to love on God. So a couple announcements before I forget. Out here, right on the foyer, there's a sign-up sheet for prayer weekend starting next Friday. It's two-hour slots, so if you have any desire to come and do that, or if you have any hesitation to come do that, I just want to encourage you and tell you it's awesome. You wonder what you're going to talk about or pray about for 2 hours, but it really just goes by in a blink of an eye. And so if you have any desire to do that, the sign-up sheet's right out there. So really excited about that, that we could, as a church, spread out and devote time for that throughout the night. So that's really, really good. Excited about that. Softball team got to play their first game last week. So work in progress. I didn't actually play that day, but ended up a lot of people showing up, nice looking shirts, so really good, lots of fun. There's no practice today for that, so with it being Father's Day, going to kind of not practice today, but game tomorrow night. Mark's House Men's Group, open to any man, 8 p.m. tomorrow night. Things Father should have taught you. So that is 10-week study, still continuing, going on. Really good. There's a women's study coming up soon. So they've been working and praying on that. It's going to start July 6th on Mondays at 6:30 p.m. If you have any questions or anything to do with that, you can talk to Deb Snyder, Natalie Moore, or Alyssa McConnell. So they're excited about that. And just really as I look through here, there's just a lot of cool, unique things that as a church, a lot of different people do. And so as a church, we get to come together and hang out a lot of times, but come together and have fun. And through it all, just have a heart to love God. So that's extremely exciting just to see things like that take place. So really excited about all that. Thank you to all the people that cook stuff for the cafe. It is always so yummy and delicious and feeds our bellies. So someone made a comment today. He's like, you're on your job, Justin, testing everything as it comes in. So it is pretty good. So thank you so much for whoever does that. And just really, really appreciate it. With everything else going on, just if you guys wouldn't mind, I'd love to share just a little cute story about my son this week, with today being Father's Day. Just been thinking a lot about my son. And I look around here, I hear babies, and I see people bringing kids, and get to be involved in a lot of kids' lives. But today we celebrate Father's Day, and it could be really a really amazing day where we it's lots of fun, but sometimes it can be kind of tough depending on your situation. But today, I just want, on Tuesday, my son and Lachelle, my wife, went to, they went somewhere. I didn't know where they were going, but they come home right before my Bible study, and Cole, my son, comes through the door, and he's only two. He'll be three in August. He's like, Daddy, close your eyes. I got a surprise. And I was like, and here comes Lachelle. No, no, it's not till Sunday, Cole. And then he's like, Daddy, I got you tools. and just so cute and adorable. But that's just a little instance of just things that my son has done this week to blow me away. He's just been on my hip almost everywhere I went this week, just wanting to be, especially since I got those tools, wanting to be helping me fix this thing or that. And just was cute one day after, because he couldn't wait to give me him. So I got my Father's Day gift on Tuesday, which I was okay with that. But so here he is trying to carry my tool bag. He's like, come on, Dad. And like trying to take in. So the step was broke, our gate was broke, and we fixed that pretty quickly. And he was trying to nail in a screw with a hammer. I was like, that's a good job, Cole. You're doing it. And just that whole day, it was just like, man, this is amazing. My son, at one point, we got the lawnmowers out. I had the push mower, and he had his little bubble one, and he was just falling right behind me. Every step I took, and I was being careful because I didn't want anything to happen. I was like, Cole, fall right behind me, and he's like, okay. And so he'd get excited and push it around, and I just truly think about that, and it just blows me away that me, a guy that's not perfect, to have my little son just do the things that I'm doing. And just to see the joy on his face when he gets to be like me and gets to fix the gate, trying to nail in a screw with a hammer. And it just brings joy to my heart, and it makes me think about, man, if I can be that excited and feel that much love from my little son, a guy that, me, that doesn't get it right all the time, how much more can God, the creator of everything, be so filled with love just for me? And I can go around the room, if I knew all your guys' names, I would say each and every one of them and say that's the way he feels about each and every one of us. And so regardless of where our father situation is, today we have a father above that created you in his image that loves you so much. And so thank you for letting me share that. It's amazing to think how much God loves us and how he just has a desire to be our father. So I'm going to pray. So Father, just thank you so much, God, for letting us call you Father. Lord, for doing everything from the very beginning so that we could call you Father, so that we would have an opportunity to have that relationship with you, Lord. God, your scripture says when we come to a place and that we accept you with our hearts and accept you with our lives, God, we're called your sons and daughters, and I thank you so much for just that. And God, through everything, through all that we do, and all that our lives are for, God, you know right where we're at. Whether we're sick, whether we're going through hard things, or whether we're just having an amazing season in our lives, God, you know it all, Lord. And through all that, God, I thank you so much for allowing us to call you Father and the way you love us. So, God, I pray that you be with us this morning. I pray that you would just bless this offering, God, that your will be done, Lord. And I pray that, God, no matter what we're going through, Lord, we just turn to you, and we love you and love you and love you. So be with us this morning. I pray that you would just bless this worship, God, that we would just go after you like never before, Lord. And then that you would just soften our hearts and open up our ears, Lord, just to hear, Lord, your will. So, God, thank you so much for all that you're doing, all you've done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
School looking for volunteers. How many would like to see the foundational principles and things of God instilled in their kids? All right, we're looking for volunteers to come and help out in that. How many is ready to worship the Lord? Are you hungry for the Lord this morning? Amen. Let's worship and praise the Lord together.
Back to the start, where you found me. I'm coming back to your heart. Now I surrender. Take me. This is all I can bring.
The love of the Lord. He says he'll never forsake us or leave us. The love of the Father. Amen. Bless you, Lord. We praise you this morning. We are made new and alive by the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
You're calling me over.
Morning, we give you glory and honor. Hallelujah. Galatians 2:20 says, I have been crucified with Christ, It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Amen. That phrase, I live by faith. What does faith mean? It's believing upon the Lord Jesus Christ and what he did for us. It says, I never give up. I press forward. I press on, no matter what the circumstances. Faith takes the answer that God gives us in the Word and says, yes, I believe. I believe on your promises, oh God. Lord, you're the God Almighty, the Prince of Peace, the Mighty God, the Most High, the Everlasting God. Lord, you're the Lord of our righteousness. Lord, it's not by our works, but by just saying yes to the Lord, our Heavenly Father. As a child, we at times may falter, or even as adults, I know that there's daily I falter. I'm a faltered girl here. But a father's love is unconditional. The father heart of our God, he loves unconditionally. Lord, we bless you, Lord. There's power in the name of Jesus, and we worship you, Lord, this morning. Jesus Messiah, the name above all names, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. We praise you, Lord, and lift you up today, Lord, for the thing that you did for us, Lord, that we might be reconciled to the Father, Lord. Our sins be forgiven. We bless your holy name.
Messiah, name
Thank you, Lord. We just thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ, the manifest glory of God in our midst. We bless your holy name, Lord. For, Lord, your light shines forth in our life, and we just bless you and praise you. God Almighty on high, we worship you, Lord. All creation, Lord, cries out and longs, Lord, for you, to know you, to have a relationship with you, Lord. It's within us, Lord, to want to worship, Lord, and we choose to worship you, Lord, and honor you and glorify you. Amen. Hallelujah.
All creation cries out with longing, with groans only you can comprehend, and with wisdom you always answer, give the words of life so unfailing, and your glory shines all around us, your faithfulness shown for all to see, when we think of all of your wonders, the beauty of your plan has been revealed, we walk in your
prayer could be prayed, Lord. You are the way, the truth, the life. You are the way. Let your light shine through each and every one of us, and let it shine from this place that all who drive by knows your glory resides here, Lord. Yes, Lord. I want to be a blessing to you. Ask you to bless the word today. Happy Father's Day to you, Lord, Father of all fathers. Let us be pleasing to you in your name. Amen.
Jesus, you are the way. Good morning, everybody. Good to see you. Happy Father's Day to everyone that that applies to. Ooh. Seems like every Father's Day, I'm going to stand right here. Dana made little louvers in that fan. Yeah, but hey, make that thing stop rotating, can you? Or does it stop? Just point it right here. Here. Pick it up. Can you pick it up? And just hold it here beside me. Oh, boy. I did a funeral yesterday. 18-year-old girl. 2 weeks after she graduated, died. Terrible, just tragic auto accident. High school gym at Mechanicsburg packed with pink. I don't know what it is about Father's Day for me, but there's always this, seems like every year there's some kind of major event that happens in my life that just keeps reminding me about, I don't know, it just has flooded into me how grateful I am for the things God's given and how he's taken care of those things over the years. And oh my goodness, just, I think I was born on Father's Day, 1964, I was born. I'm a Father's Day baby. I was born on Father's Day. The sad thing was, 27 years later, my dad died on Father's Day, 1991. See what I'm talking about? Father's Day just, ooh. Dad died in 1991. I've been without a dad. I guess that's not true. Jamie's dad, my wife's dad, kind of picked me up as a dad for a while, and he passed away last year, and and in our life, Jamie and I, we've been married 30 years. We got married on Father's Day weekend there. So my birthday, my anniversary, everything, this was, so it's been an exciting week for us. 30 years married this week, and I was thinking, it's probably all. But not long after we were married, a man came to stay with us a year or so, and we've had men with us for about 30 years. Somebody staying with us all the time, four kids we've raised, and I think in our home right now there's quite a few more that would consider me dad. I don't know, some way or another they're kind of grown, and I don't know. What a privilege it is to be able to help people develop in life. You know, that makes sense. God himself called himself Father. We live in a society where, you know, fathers get made fun of. You know, dads on the sitcoms are the dumb. And it fits us. It fits. Sometimes it fits. But I just have a lot to share with you today about being a dad. And I hope you enjoy all that, okay? I have a lot of emotion in it because it's just close to me. How much I enjoy doing that. How hard that is. How I have come to understand it over the years more and more. Father, would you bless our time together today? We love you. Dana stole my line there. You're the best father we could ever have. We stop right now, Lord, to say thank you for you. Thank you, God, that you have fathered every one of us. God, when we were lost and empty and broken, God, when we needed challenged and disciplined, and God, you've been all those things to us over all the years. You've been our provider, you've been our strength, our help. Lord, I can't say a thing today that doesn't just totally parallel who you've been and what you are in my life. And God, I pray as we speak today, we just see your amazing love and care for us, and that you've never, ever, ever stopped thinking about us. So we're just grateful this day, Lord. In my heart, I'm just so very grateful how things could be much different than they are in my life, Lord. But you've come and protected and saved and blessed and given to me. And I am so very grateful. Thank you, Lord, for this time together. I pray, God, that you'd kind of just harness my emotion a little bit today, Lord, and just cause us to be very effective in your word. And Lord, just cause it to be powerful and good, just good and glorious for you. May we honor you as a father today, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. I think we're Matthew first, aren't we, Colin? I left my notes in my another vehicle this morning and went off. I haven't had notes all day, and oh well. So, Matthew chapter 7, Jesus preaching here the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' words. Now, we believe that Jesus was forever, eternal, with God in the past. So Jesus, the Son of God, was forever with God as His Son. Does that make sense? Don't ask me to explain that, because I just gave you the best explanation you're ever going to get. That's how the Scripture teaches us, okay? So Jesus had an eternal kind of eternal past perspective about the Father God. And here's one of the best places where he begins to teach about the Father and about fathering. And here's how he goes. In fact, this is in the context of asking your Father, who knows you have need of things, and he wants you just to ask. Now, I can tell you a lot of stories, because we are at the place I'm kind of in the middle of the sandwich right now. We still have kids at home. We have kids gone. I have a dad that has passed. I now help dad's father, you know, so I'm just in the middle of that whole, in the middle of, for me, fathering just every day. And, you know, it's important that children to have a conversation with their father. It's important that when they have need, they talk to their father. This week, little Connor, our little guy, 14-year-old, when I say little guy, he's not that little anymore, but two things he wanted this week, and I can tell you those stories. He got his phone wet. We were spraying some stuff off, got his phone wet. It kind of might have been on purpose a little, because his phone is getting a little old. I'm not a big believer in kids having cell phones, but when they start playing sports and we got to pick them up, and we don't believe in putting the whole world in our kids' hands. We don't do that with our kids, but we will get them ability to contact us. And once they do that, we, as they get older, we let them contact their friends a little bit and all that. But he doesn't have the coolest, latest phone, which is exactly what we want. So his phone got a little bit wet and it stopped working. He made sure a bunch of times this week. He told me his phone wasn't working. He's 14. His job this summer is to work with dad. A couple times I said, hey, if you need a phone, I pull out my flip phone, just flip over. Here's a phone, you need it. He's like, no, I need a phone. You're working with your dad all summer, you really don't need a phone. He wasn't very happy about that. We were in the store the other day, and I was in there, and one of the guys that are with us needed something. We're picking up something. I think we were in Walmart, and we picked up something. He said, I need a baseball bat. Connor, we got baseball bats everywhere. You don't need a baseball bat. I really need a baseball bat. So we went through the line, and we bought something for one of the guys that were with us. And at coming out of the store, he looked at me and said, but I'm your kid. You bought something for him, and you didn't buy me a bat. I said, yeah, you're my kid, but you don't need a bat. This is in the context of asking, but it says, or what man is there among you who, if he has a son, if the son asks for bread, will give him a stone? And what kind of father are you if your son asks for just anything, that you give him just anything? I wish I could just openly talk to you today, but I think part of being a father is giving them things or providing what the need is, or recognizing there is a need and trying to help and all those things. But it also isn't giving them things that brings them to ruin. Now, I will tell you right now, there are two people in my life right now, and because I'm not their father, my total goal is to spoil the heck out of them. And that's my two grandkids. Right? I'm not their dad, so I don't. My grandkids, they might come over later today for Father's Day. And my goal is, when mom ain't looking, to get out the big old barrel of ice cream, get out a spoon. Both of them are just little enough now. Mom kind of watches their diet a little bit. Grandpa don't care. You know what I mean? My goal today is get out some ice cream and slide them some ice cream every time mom ain't looking. And I'm telling you, I'm going to be their favorite. I'm telling you, I'm going to be their favorite. But my sons are a totally different story. Does that make sense? My daughter, my single daughter, by the way, my single daughter was harder than my three sons all together to raise. And she'll tell you that was true. What kind of dad doesn't help when he's supposed to? Now, we live in a culture, I'll just tell you today, the biggest thing in the American culture that's really, really broken is that dads aren't dads. I'm in situations you're not in so much, but I'm in a situation pretty often where we're in jails and prisons, and the biggest issue in jails and prisons are the dad relationship wasn't what it should have been. Dad is either in the homes where people have a lot of things, dads are either gone because they're working all the time, or in poorer situations often, dad's just not been there ever. I was in a group, I think, of 11 men not that long ago, and I was teaching these things. I felt like the Lord gave me 26 things that my father should have taught me, and the concept that their father should have taught him anything is just not there in some of these men. And I said, how many of y'all have a close relationship with your father, the 11 men that were in jail? And none of them had. The whole concept that dad should have been in their life teaching them something just wasn't there at all. And I could tell you story after story after story, funny story. I could tell you a funny story. My oldest son that's an architect now, when he was a boy, he did not like working with dad in the garage. And I would always tell him, son, your dad can teach you things, and if your dad teaches you things, you'll have them for life. I'm just this big believer. The more you can learn in life, the more skill you can get in life at an early age, those things you have for life. Does that make sense? I learned how to swim as a young boy. Guess what? I can jump in the water now and swim. I learned how to ride a bicycle. You know what I mean? And it's just like that. The things that I was taught young at the age, I was raised on a bulldozer and backhoe. I was raised on heavy equipment. I'm not afraid of that. I'd go out here right now, jump on something, and push your house down. That's a joke. I'm just joking. But just skills and confidence come with skill. Does that make sense? And a father-son relationship, there's just something in that. My job, listen, at first is for my kids to see me do something. Then my job is to put my hands on my kids' hands to show them how to do something. Then my job, and it's becoming that more as our kids go, my job is to stand back and just give some instruction and let them do and fail and try again. But my son Charlie did not like to work in the garage with me, and I would always tell him, and he'd always say, Dad, I'm going to go to college. I get good grades in school. I'm going to go to college. I'm going to get a professional job. I'm not going to be in the garage. I'm not going to do this when I get older. I don't want to be out here with you. I don't like this. And I'd say, son, I don't care. And I taught him how to change oil and work on lawnmower, just a whole bunch of things. It gave him enough confidence that he could do it. The first job he ever got was working for a farmer up the road. And when things broke down, Charlie just grabbed some wrenches and started turning wrenches. And because he would turn wrenches, the farmer said, you know how to wrench, don't you? He said, well, yeah, I work with my dad. He said, well, since you do, I'm going to pay you a couple more dollars an hour and keep you here in the barn a lot more to wrench for me. He's like, oh. So his very first job, he got a job where he had to wrench a bunch, and I loved it. I thought it was great. To this very day, now he's working at a big architecture firm, you know, and he's doing that stuff. He still calls. In fact, today, I think when he comes over, he'll probably bring some quarts of oil. Changes oil at our house while he's there. Isn't it funny? There's something about a dad. Here's the biggest thing I can probably tell you today. There's something about a father. The father is able to see beyond the moment. A father doesn't get caught up in the moment very often. As a dad, I'm not too caught up in the emotion of a whole lot of stuff that's going on. That makes sense. But what I'm trying to see is the bigger picture. Trying to see the strengths and weaknesses of my kids are very important. Try to get them to mature in areas they're not very mature in. Try to encourage them in areas that they could really have great success in. It's been a chore. But not one time, I just tell you, not one time, I've got a son right now listening to this here. Not one time have I ever not loved them. They think I'm madder than fire at them sometimes. They think I'm the total jerk sometimes. They think, listen, my job as a dad is to set a bar. You know, I don't know if you understand that. I don't try to set the bar too high where my kids can't get over it. That would just be foolish. And I don't set the bar too low that they can step over it easy and not challenge them. I don't want to set the bar just right. That makes sense? This is the standard in our home, and this is what my expectations are of you. And if you want to come and you want to jump under that bar, that's not good enough for me. I'll put the bar right there where you have to work to get over, where you're challenged every day about being who you should be and learning and growing and being a, growing up for our boys, growing up to be men. I believe in producing men. I talk to my, please don't forgive me for this, but there's a lot of things nowadays that I consider the girl world. Does that make sense? When my boys are into clothes, I call it the girl world. When they're into their cell phones a bunch, I call that the girl world. And I look at my boys often and say, why are you living in a girl world? You're going to grow up and be a man. We're trying to produce men that aren't, listen to me, that aren't driven by the winds and the waves and the things of life, that have steadiness and solidness. And as a pastor, I just want you to know something. There are things that happen that at times get us upset and, you know, and this thing and that thing. But we try our very best just to be very steady, looking at the big picture, looking at the road that's ahead. You know what I mean? I always felt like I need to be in my home. I need to be a dock. That's what I need to be. The waves are out there bouncing, you know, things around. And if I can just be the dock, if I can be the stable dock, then guess what? Then all that stuff, hey, at some point, what's the steadiness of what I bring to the home? And they'll tie up to me because I don't move a whole lot. I come to church and cry. You see me cry more than any. I don't cry much at home, but I'm telling you something. I just feel like men need to be, listen, real men need to be real men. They need to be lovers of their wives and lovers of their children and protectors and providers and good in heart. Listen, God shows us every day what it is to be a dad. Now, because earthly men can't be everything God is, God created moms. Thank God for them. There's nothing better than a mom. I'm just telling you. And that's why all the athletes on TV go, hi, mom. Right? Because the greatest gift ever given to us is a mom. You understand? Hey. But there's something about a dad that's the most powerful thing there is in our life. Dad would be like, if the athletes got on TV and went, hi, dad. Dad would be going, I taught you not to do that. At our house, I always say, hey, on Mother's Day, let's get mom something, you know? On Father's Day, what do you want? I don't want nothing. I don't want nothing. The greatest thing, can I just tell you? The greatest thing, and I'm talking about God stuff, Father stuff, I'm talking about both directions here. The greatest thing you can ever get from your kids is for them to listen to the important things they're trying to tell you. You hear me? That's the greatest thing a dad wants for his kids is, will you listen to me when I'm trying to speak the most powerful things you need in your life? Because I stand right here before you and I know you and I know what you need and I know what's broken and I'm not afraid to speak it. I don't care if you're mad. I don't care if it upsets you. It doesn't matter to me. I say all the time, we do this at our house. The kids will come in the morning, and when Jamie is at home, they'll say, can I have ice cream for breakfast? I always say, I'm not a mom. I don't care. Can we have Mountain Dew on our cereal? I don't care. I'm not a mom. But in those important areas, the greatest thing that I feel like, hey, I want my kids to do is listen to me, because what I'm trying to speak to them is truth. not so they fail, not to feel like I'm beating them up, not to torture them or to, you know what I mean, but to really speak truth in their life, because I don't want them living below where they can live. I don't want them to be less than what God created them to be. And then just in our human nature, often if there isn't somebody challenging us to be more than we want to be, then we'll live far less than that. That makes sense? There's high schools in our area. Now, just for example, and some have really good football teams, and some of them not so good. You understand? And I've watched coaches move, good coaches move to different schools, and it just takes a few years, and guess what? All of a sudden, that football team that wasn't very good has this good coach, and all of a sudden, that football team, guess what? Starts to be a pretty good football team, right? And I've learned in my life that leadership matters, and I've learned in my life that people that press people a little bit more than they want to go really is doing a great favor to people. That makes sense? Pushing you to be your very best, pushing you to not live at some standard you set for yourself, but a standard that somebody that knows your potential has set for you. You get that whole thing? And God's able to do us all the time. I never wanted to be a public speaker. Never. I tell this story. I think 7th or 8th grade, I took an F on a public speaking thing, and I think I had to speak, I want to say it was like a 3-minute speech or something. I couldn't stand in front of people for 3 minutes and speak. Shoot, 3 minutes. But God pressed me beyond where he knew the potential I had in me. Does that make sense? He knew what he created me to be. And he wasn't going to let me settle for something. Listen, in this world, too many people are settling for less. My kids love their coaches. Kids usually love their coaches because they realize their coaches are trying to get the best out of them. But sometimes they're really angry with their dad. They don't see the comparison between a coach and a dad. You know what I mean? They don't realize that dads, I guess because dads just stay on them and stay on them, they can't get away from them. My brother said one time, Dad, we had an excavation business growing up. My brother said to him, Dad, I don't want to work for you anymore because you can't fire me and I can't quit. What kind of man wouldn't give his son bread when he needed it? There ain't one of us that would do that. Next one. Same thought kind of. If you ask for a fish, will he give him a serpent? No. No. Next. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, this is the comparison of an earthly father compared to God, who's much better at being a father. He's saying, you fathers, that you really being evil, it's not mean you're being evil, it means you're being lesser of a father than God has the ability to be. How much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? You thinking like I'm thinking? What that says to me is, my God in heaven loves me so much that he wants to give me good things. I don't know. Sometimes I guess our thinking gets messed up from time to time. You know, sometimes we get to thinking, well, God is mad at me or whatever. Listen, God's this father that he's going to discipline us in time. In fact, there's some verses here. But what God wants to do is give us the things we need. There's nothing better for me. There's nothing better for me that brings me glory or brings me honor than my kids succeeding. I would be a fool of a man if I would do things that cause my kids not to succeed. They don't realize that when I'm hard on them, we need to get these other verses, but when I'm hard on them, what the big picture is, I just want them to succeed. Because this next set of verses is calling it Hebrews. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons. The writer of Hebrews is saying, you've forgotten this thing that God does, haven't you? You've forgotten how God works. And he goes on to say, this is what God says. My son, do not Do not despise the chastening or the discipline of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by Him. Uh-oh. Now, how's the best way to say this? If I did not care for my children, why would I care about correcting them? In fact, it sounds funny, but for a father, it shows much more love to correct things than to just let them go. I'm a big believer that the role of a father in the home, hey, is really to get things in order. Really, to work on things that are broken in our children. That makes sense? Now, you know this. From Adam and Eve, we were all born with a sinful nature in us. And there's not a kid out there that doesn't have that ornery nature about him.
Right.
Hey, we've talked about this quite a lot. But who's the most important figures in a child's life? Mom and dad. Right? Right now in psychology, they're doing a lot of study about this. How much is it that really parenting affects the life of, and they're finding that 60% basically of what a person becomes has everything to do with how they were parented. 40% are outside sources or other influences or decisions they made or those kind of things. But basically, 60% of who you are was determined by your parents, roughly 60% by how your parents influenced your life. Now, I don't know how you feel about that, but I'll tell you right now, if I'm 60%, that's more than the majority. Does that make sense? So to understand about my kids that they are influenced the very most by who mom and dad are in their life, man, that just says to me that I have a great ability to shape my child's life. Now, every child's different, and I will say to you just really clearly, boys and girls are very, very different. Y'all believe me? Yeah. We could stay here all day and I could just tell you kids' stories all day long about how I've come to learn that. My daughter would get so upset with me because it would work on mom. She'd just start crying when I was getting on her. She'd start crying. And she'd start crying some more. And she'd just start, her lips start quivering. And I'm just getting on her. And I finally just look at her and say, that doesn't work with me. It's pretty funny how quickly she dried that up. It's pretty quickly how that just went away. Then she would do this thing that was probably more effective with me. She'd get real mad at me. In fact, I'll tell you this story. It's really a good dad story. The stupidest thing I've probably ever done as a pastor was my daughter wanted me to marry her when she got married. And though I, tough guy, never want to show, you know, I'm crazy about that girl. And I was fine, and I've done hundreds and hundreds of weddings, and everything was fine, and I was going along good. And although when I married my daughter, I sit down to these words that I had used for years and years and years. I sit down, and I threw away all those words, and I said, I'm going to write brand new words, something that's really personal, something that's really special, to speak over my daughter and over her husband at her wedding. But I'm doing fine. In fact, as I'm writing those words, I'm just sobbing. I'm sobbing. And so I think I'll get all these tears out of the way and I'll be fine. And I was fine on wedding day. I was fine when mom would, you know, she'd put on her wedding dress and she'd come out of the house and just show. And I'm just looking at her like, oh, you're killing me. You're killing me. But I just tough it out, you know. And it's getting closer to the day she's getting married, closer, and I'm going, what can I do? What can I give her to not do it? How can I? I said this story at the wedding. What I was looking for was a man that would love her as much as me. And there was a couple things that Trent did that proved to me he did. So there was no reason why I could, even though I didn't want it to happen, there was no reason why I couldn't let her get married, because this man had proven to me he loved her as much as I did. So we're back there just a few minutes before it's time to walk her down the aisle, And all of a sudden, something comes over me that's never come over me before. All of a sudden, I got emotion I've never had before. All of a sudden, I got something in my stomach that I don't got before, you know. And I'm looking at my daughter, and I'm just saying to her, honey, all of a sudden, there's some, I don't know if I can do this. This all of a sudden got really hard, you know, when the guests are there and everybody's getting ready. The wedding's about to take off, the whole thing. And I'm looking at her, I don't know why. It's probably the hardest I ever cried before. I just stood before and I was just wailing, crying. And she's like, Dad, this is my wedding day. This is supposed to be happy. Don't make me cry. I got all this makeup and stuff on. You're going to mess me up. I'm saying, maybe I'm sorry. I'm not doing this on purpose. It's just something that came over me. I don't know where it came from. It's just killing me. And I looked at her one moment. I said, Mags, I'm not sure I can do this today. All of a sudden, she went, now, Dad, you quit it. You just straighten up and you get your butt down here. You've done this a whole bunch of times. You can do it. Now, if you don't, I'm going to be mad at you for the rest of your life. Now, shut up and get out of here. I'm like, oh, yeah, now I remember. Now I remember. I'd be glad to give you away. So she got mad at me and yelled at me. It's the one time her dad needed it. And she yelled at me and made me mad enough. I went down there and said, pretty much, Trent, get her out of here. Nor be discouraged when you're rebuked by him. See, I think what happens sometimes when kids get disciplined, they forget that a father does that out of love, and they start to believe a father does that out of anger. And it discourages them because often kids feel like they can't ever get it right. You get me? How would you feel if you felt like you could never get it right? Don't you become discouraged? But this is what they don't know. This is what kids don't know. That dads, listen to me, dads know what you can do, and they're not going to stop until you do it. See, kids always want to push back on dads and say, you've got to stop, you know, you're just on me all the time, you're on me all the time, you're on me all the time, you got to stop, you got to. But what a dad knows is, no, I know exactly what you can achieve and you're not there yet, so I'm not quitting. Even though you're trying to guilt me into something, my will and my understanding of you and my love for you says we're not where we need to be yet. That's why, this sounds funny, but that's why when your children leave the home, this is what I think is amazing. They long for their father to speak to them even after they're married. I feel like for my married children, the words that I speak to them at this point in their life are more powerful than they've ever been in their life, because the one who stayed on them to try to produce quality in their life is the one they want to speak to them again when they're unsure about where life goes from here. Does that make sense? My son called me. He was having to work two jobs. He's out of school, an architect at an architect firm, and doing okay. But he had to, his wife, they got two little babies, and his wife had to be home with them, so he's working a second job, and it's just killing their marriage, and he's gone all the time. And he, at one point, he says, Dad, what do I do? Things are really hard. I said, Charlie, you got to pray that God will give you a better job so you don't have to work that second job. Charlie, you got to pray. Now, this sounds funny. There's just a relationship you have with your kids that they're listening to everything you say, and they don't always say something back because they got to process, you know, and the whole thing. But I bet you my son went and prayed and said, God, my dad said pray. He didn't have another answer. He didn't have a salute. He didn't have an earthly way to fix it. But he said, you'll pray, God will help you, Charlie. God will help you. I've told Charlie 1,000 times in my life, over and over, God will help you, Charlie. God will help you. When life is too hard, when it doesn't make sense, when it's broken, when you don't know where to go, if you ask God, he will help you. Yeah. He always has. He always will. Because he's a good father that cares about me. Well, guess what? He called me one day and says, Dad, I got on with this new architect firm. The money's so much better. I won't have to work a second job. And I just thought in my heart, you prayed. I hate to keep telling you kids stories, but I think it makes spiritual points. Our daughter Maggie's in Peru. When she was home this last month, one of our old pastors prophesied over and said, you need to do what God's telling you to do. You need to do that. And as soon as he spoke that, they just busted out crying. And the day before they left, she told my wife, God had been speaking to them about taking in more kids. What's funny is they got back to Peru, and the first thing that happened, they got evicted. Not evicted, but the people that they owned the home they were living in were coming back there, so they asked them to leave. So the first thing they had to do was go find a house, and they knew they needed to go find a bigger house because they're, you know, it's just how funny how God. See, I'm this big believer, and I said it in an elder deacon meeting yesterday. I'm a believer that God is so on top of where we are that every single thing that happens to us has such a spiritual meaning in it. And sometimes we don't have enough understanding to know why that's happening, but certainly that's a God thing. So they've been looking for these bigger houses. They've been calling Jamie and telling us how much these bigger houses are. And they, you know, they're living in Peru. It's pretty cheap to live, but they're living just barely, you know, how missionaries live. They just live at the very edge of. And a bigger house is more money, and they've been going to these houses, and they call and say, well, this is a lot more money. And Jamie would say, and we'd say, how much more? And they'd say, well, a lot more. And I would say back to Jamie, because usually Jamie's on the phone, and I'm talking to Jamie. You know how it works. That your mom's always talking to daughter, and dad's are. And I say, and they, you know how it works. It's a lot more. And I would say, Jamie, tell her, keep looking. Finally got the place this week where I know they were just falling on their knees saying, God, what do you spoke something to us while we were home. Nothing here seems to be affordable. Will you help us? And they showed this home, I think on Facebook, there's some pictures of it. They looked at this home this week and felt like that's where God wanted them to be and went to the lady and said, it's just too expensive for us. This is all the money we have. It's all we can do. And the lady said, I'll take it. So they are over the top excited. And I think I'm going to pick up some more grandkids pretty quickly. Hey, they speak a different language than me. You know, being a dad's a pretty awesome thing. I'm sure God looks at his job and says, I love doing this. I love doing this for kids that'll listen to my voice. Now, there's some kids, boy, I hate to have to discipline them. I hate to have to run them down. I hate to have to keep chasing them. In fact, in the first service, I kind of said this, and I believe this to be true, so true in our society today, that God is so often trying to talk to us as a father. What he wants us to do is just submit to him. Does that make sense? And I know in so many ways in our life, what God asks us to do is difficult. God's trying to hold us to a holiness standard. God's trying to hold us to something that this world has forgotten about completely. Does that make sense? But it's still the standard that God has for our life. Not because God wants to kill us, but because God made the rules. And he wants to bless us within his rules. Does that make sense? So what happens to people is this generally, that God begins to convict them of what's broken. You know how that is, right? And God would wish that they would just honor him and do it because he told them it was wrong. But people these days are pretty good at sliding off conviction or, you know, just kind of put that, just keep that. We're real good. In football, there's something called a stiff arm, you know what I mean? Where a guy comes up to tackle and you just put your arm out. And if you can keep him at arm's distance, he can't get his arms around you where he can tackle, you know? So we're pretty good at stiff arming the Holy Spirit, you know? We just put our arm out hard enough where he can't get his arms around us and we try to slide past that tackle. catch me? And go on, and he'll come again at us. We'll put a stiff arm. We just push him back just enough. You know, we know we need him, and we know he's probably, but what we got is more important than what the Lord's speaking. So we just push him, you know, Holy Spirit, we just keep him off. So what happens is then God just comes at us a little. You see, the Lord never stops. He's faithful to finish what he began in you. So he's not going to stop chasing you till you get it. And the year, the days or the weeks or the months or the years that you keep putting him off, well, it's just going to get more miserable. Right? So next thing you know, you're punching around on a radio and a preacher is going to be right there on that radio and he's going to be speaking to you and you're going to reach out real quick and you're going to turn that radio off. John Omnis told a story this morning about a guy, Charles Stanley, on the radio speaking to him one day and how God was dealing with him and he turned the radio and Charlie Stanley speaking right into or you turn on the TV, or you come to church, and the pastor just nailed it. Right? Anybody? No, I won't ask you to. Anybody ever been here, and the pastor just like, people tell me this all the time. Did somebody tell you about my life? Did somebody talk to you? No, I'm just doing what I do, man, trying to listen to the Holy Spirit. Sometimes I get way off the subject when I preach, and I go home going, why in the world did I get way off the subject? And people come to me later saying, man, you killed me. Or better yet, they come a year later and they say, remember when you killed me? No, I don't remember. So what happens is this, either you got to respond to God or... in today's society, I'm just going to be straight with you. We run. There are people not in church today, not because they don't love us, not because they don't believe we've done, tried to speak it. In fact, they run from us because they know we are speaking into their lives, and they don't want to deal with that, so they run off. You know what I mean? And this is what I know about people. Can I just tell you what I know about people? Most people are prideful enough that once they've ran off to a place where God never wanted them to be, they end up staying there often because what pride they have inside themselves says, I can't go back. The devil will jump in, and what the devil does real good, he'll jump in and say, well, see, now that's broken. So a lot of people, this sounds crazy, but it happens all the time. A lot of people, God's convicting them, and God makes it real clear what he wants them to do, but they kind of slide off that. Then they got to run away. Then they got to get, I got to get away from this. Then they get someplace away from God. They know they're under conviction, even though the longer you continue in it and the less conviction is effective in your life. But then they're prideful enough not to make their way back to what God's will was for their life. Now, did God run them off? No. Did God love them? Yeah. Colin, we got to go. Let's go. Let's hit a bunch of these verses real quick. No, we know and understand this discipline thing. I got about 13 verses here. I won't get through all of them. Just Father's Day verses, okay? Beautiful verses right here. Joshua, have I not commanded you, be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid or dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. I just threw that in there because I love that verse no matter what. Dads, listen, the only time I've made great mistakes in my life is when I became afraid to do what I should have done. Anytime I've taken courage, listen, it's easier just to lay back. And men are really good at it, by the way. It's easier to lay back and not deal with something than to take it on. Hear me? Have courage. Next one. These words which I command to you today shall be in your heart. Next one. And you shall teach them diligently to your children and talk to them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise up. I just want to tell you this. My dad, for a short period of time in his life, became this wonderful Christian man. He was at a very impactful time in my life. And I serve the Lord today because in those 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 years, my dad served the Lord with all his might. The greatest thing I can ever tell you. Well, the day my dad came to the Lord, he went to the fireplace in our house and burnt every dirty magazine he had. I'll never forget it. To see my dad in church with tears running down his face and his hands up. Listen to me. Justin told you today how that little boy, his little boy, wants to follow him around. Listen, that made me want to worship God. You hear me? If I'll teach them, they'll follow. If I'll teach them God things, they'll be God people. If I don't, they won't. In our society today, God is left out of so much stuff that there are literally kids now being raised that have no God, nothing in them. I can't believe it. I can't believe that adults have got to the place where they just don't see any value. It just drives me crazy. And to speak to them often, they just want to push you away. Go on here. Hurry, hurry. And you shall bind them on your hand. And on the, before, that's that whole teach your children. Go on, next one. Next one, Colin. Next one. That's just for time's sake. Next one. You seen these pictures? Love this verse, just a great verse. Joshua speaking at the end of his life, he makes his declaration. And if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourself this day who you'll serve, whether the gods of your fathers that they served on the other side of the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I just see Joshua standing before people saying, hey, I don't know what you're doing. It was one of those times where the people were getting off track with God again. I don't know if you're going to serve those gods that you served when you were in Egypt or serve the gods that are here in this land. Pretty much saying, I can't believe you're doing that. But for me and my house, we're serving the Lord. My kids, Jamie and I love the Lord. I married a girl that loved the Lord more than me. And my advice for anybody that's going to get married is find somebody that loves the Lord more than you do, and you're going to have a happy life. But the great thing about our children is we raised our children in church. Will they make mistakes? Yeah. Do they have a basis or a foundation? Yes. Do I believe that that will become bigger in their life than the choices of the world? I do. But we have said in our home, we have said, we'll serve the Lord first. Colin, we just running out of time here. There's one verse here about three or four generations. I'd like to hit that. Can you go to the next one? Next one. Sorry, I just got to get where I got to go on. I'm not sure which one it is. So next one, you seen these pictures? Isn't that good pictures? Go on. I think we've missed it. I missed it somewhere. Let's go to those 26 things. I just want to run over these 26 things. I feel like the Lord gave me the dads ought to be teaching their children. What we got, a picture? Oh, there. Isn't that a neat picture? We need men who try to love us. Okay. And then you saw Spock, right? Betty, are you torturing me back there? Here they are. We got to end. 26 things I feel like dads need to teach their children. Number one and most important. Listen, if they get the next 25 right and they don't get the first one right, they're lost for eternity. You could have, well, what's the verse? Gain the whole world and lose your soul. I think the King James says, and what's that profit you? God loves you, love Him back. Is that hard? In fact, I found in a relationship, if somebody loves me, it's really easy to love them back. So what God's doing for us is really pretty easy for us to do. If we'll start just recognizing His love in our life, it's pretty easy to love Him back. I got to hurry. Teach our children to work hard and pay attention. That decision-making defines your life. To be finishers. Honesty builds trust. Good things happen. Next one. Winner or loser is really leader or loser, because if you're going to be a winner, you got to have some leader qualities in you. You got to learn how to be a leader if you're ever going to be a winner. Respect is earned. I love this one. The opposite sex is very different. Our kids need that. Video games turn your brain to mush. That was several years ago. I wish I'd have put cell phones, turn your brain to mush. The point is, anything that consumes a lot of your time that doesn't produce the value of time, and how crazy it is to waste time of something with something that has very little value. Bad choices are like a wrecking ball. People are watching you. Too late costs more. Next set. Your mouth builds or destroys. Stop thinking. Don't brag on yourself. Get out of the box. That's a story about don't try to live your life the way everybody else does. I don't care if everybody else has belt jeans. Is it belt or buckle? Buckle jeans. No matter. I don't care. Skills are for life. I'm writing to children. School is your job. You get that? School, how important school is. Life isn't fair. Get over it. Next one. Words of others should not define you. What somebody says about me. Right? Do the next right things. Feelings can blind you. Learn something new every day. There are two sides to every story. And the last one, pick your battles. Those are the 26 things I think men need to be teaching their children. And if you don't teach them that, where are they going to get it? It's a great responsibility to be a dad. Hey, and it's a wonderful thing to have a father like God. Listen to me. If you have a father that you know deep down, although he gets on your case and you get upset with him, you know he loves you and you know he's trying to teach you and he know he's trying to make you better, you ought to thank God for him. He's a gift from God in your life. I know he gets on your nerves. I know he pushes you to, But God put him there to do something in you that you would never do on your own. Lord, thanks for time together today. We love and appreciate you. I pray, God, just as you're this great Father, Lord, that loves and cares and disciplines, that we might in kind be the same. I thank you, Lord, that about 60% of my children is defined by me. Let me do those things right, Lord. Remind me again that you're trying to show me how to do this. And that you're the greatest example I could follow to get it right. I thank you for my children. I thank you for their gift in my life. I thank you, God, for a great Father in heaven who loves me. And I pray, God, today we connected a lot of those pieces. Lord, calls us all to step up to the mature place where we need to be. And let this message today help us, Lord, in understanding. Thank you for this day. Thank you for Father's Day. Thank you for every father in this place. May we honor you with our lives, with our decisions, with our thoughts, and with our plans. And we'll forever give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming, everybody. Thanks for being here. We love you very much. Come back again. Please come back again. There we go. Very good. Very good.